And it is good to be with you guys. We're excited for our Youth-Led Service 2022. And as you can tell, it's entitled Legendary. And we're going to talk what it means to be legendary and who is legendary in just a moment. But before I do that, I have to go back to one of the announcements for just a second, because there was somebody in this church who challenged or issued a challenge to all of Liberty Church. That's a brave man right there. Not just is it any brave man, no, it is your very own pastor, Pastor John Bradley. He issued a challenge. By the way, great job last week, Pastor John. Can we give it up for Pastor John? He is just an amazing teacher. So appreciate you. But so apparently, and this is literally what he texted me, he is a force to be reckoned with when it comes to Scrabble. So we have a board game thing coming up in a couple of weeks here, and he is there to take on anybody to beat him in Scrabble. And if there is anybody here, I will give you a prize if you can beat him. We want him to be beaten. The challenge is out. So on November the 11th, if you guys can join us for it, it's going to be awesome. It's going to be a lot of fun. So join us for that. And again, Pastor John's got the challenge out there. Again, welcome to Youth-Led 2022, entitled Legendary. Very, very excited to kind of unpack this idea of what it means to be legendary. And let me assure you, even as we get started, that you are here this morning for a reason. God has ordained this moment and time for you to be here and to hear what God is going to say to us this morning. Now, I come to church for numerous reasons. I want to see my friends. I want to see you guys. I want to hang out with you. But I really come to hear from God. Amen. Because this is one of the places where God speaks, and I want to hear him. I want him to change my life. So I want that every time that I walk into church. And here's what I know, that God has a plan for your life. Let me try this side. Here's what I know, that God has a plan for your life. I know if I were to go over there right now, you would outdo them. So we're just going to let that go, though. Just, I understand. Now, even though we know this, and we somewhat believe this too, our actions sometimes are different. See, the problem is that God has a plan, a perfect plan for us, but we also have a plan for our lives. And sometimes they don't sync up completely. And when they don't sync up completely, usually what happens with most of us, we're like, well, this is what I want to do. So you go over in that direction. See, God has a perfect plan for you, and it's going to be amazing if you actually walk it out. A few months ago, we were reading in our one-year Bible reading in the book of Acts, and we were talking about Stephen, and it was said that Stephen was a man full of the Spirit of God. And it dawned on me again, like it does every time I read that verse, that if Stephen was full of the Spirit of God, that means there was nothing left of Stephen in him. And that is really the way that we fulfill the plan of God in our lives, when the Holy Spirit will come in and completely take control of our lives. That's when cool things can happen. When we have a plan and our plan is in sync with God's plan, and then we go forward and do something amazing together. Robert Murray McChain said this: let the Holy Spirit fill every chamber of your heart, so that there will be no room for folly, or for the world, or Satan, or the flesh. If we want to live legendary lives, Liberty Church, Jesus needs to be the center and the priority of everything that we do. In other words, our lives need to be Jesus-centric. That means we have a grid through which we look through everything that we do. That means if we go out and we hang out with friends, we see, okay, is this really all about Jesus? When we go to a party, when we listen to music, when we watch movies, whatever it is that we do, we look through this grid and make sure that, is this all about Jesus? Now, before I really get in trouble and start preaching right away, let me kind of come back a little bit and let me just pray so that God will speak to us this morning. Can we do that? Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for these few moments that we have together. And I pray that you would come in this place. Holy Spirit, we make room for you, and we want you to move. Holy Spirit, I declare my dependence upon you, and I ask that you remove me from behind this pulpit, and that my words will be yours this morning. Speak to us this morning. Change our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Now again, our theme is legendary. Legendary means the following: to be remarkable enough to be famous. Very well known. Many stories are told about them. So when we call someone legendary, we mean that they are famous. They were influencers or are influencers. They have influenced society or culture in some way, shape, or form. And if that is our definition, then there's plenty of people that can fall into that category. People that are influencers, people that have done something. As a matter of fact, we could name name after name after name of people that we could even think of. And so what I did is I Googled who was the most famous person in 2022. And I have to be honest with you, I was a little shocked by number one. Now, there were quite a few people on there that I think most of us would know and say, yeah, I guess they're somewhat famous or have done something. You have Elon Musk, you have LeBron James, President Joe Biden, Will Smith, Justin Bieber, Cristiano Ronaldo, who is apparently 402 million fans on Instagram. That's a lot of people following you. All these people. And then the number one spot, again, it was hard to believe, went to Dwayne Johnson, The Rock. And I thought to myself, what has this guy done that is so remarkable that he, early on in 2022, was the most famous person in the world? What have you done, Dwayne Johnson, that is so remarkable?
What can I say except you're welcome for the tides, the sun, the sky? Hey, it's okay, it's okay.
Well, Dwayne Johnson, who is the one that was singing right there out of the movie Moana, in case you're totally lost what is going on. But thank you so much for creating the tides, the sun, and the sky. That's pretty amazing. And if you truly did that, that would be legendary indeed. But wait, he wasn't the one that created the sun, the stars, and the sky. That was somebody else in history altogether. As a matter of fact, if you look down and see who is famous in history, you have quite a few people that you can name: Shakespeare, Napoleon, Aristotle, Alexander the Great. But guess who is still in the number one spot and will always be in the number one spot of the most famous, most legendary people of all? Jesus. He is still the number one, and he will always be the number one. I told you that our life should be Jesus-centric. He truly is legendary, and there are so many stories that are told about him. In John 21, 25, we read the following: "And there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written." Amen. Remember, our definition of what it means to be legendary is to be remarkable enough to be famous. Very well known. Many stories are told about them. And there is no one, church, no one that is more remarkable and more legendary than Jesus. He truly lived a remarkable life, and he still impacts us to this day. And you are a prime example of that. The most legendary one of all, the only legendary one, is Jesus, not just a person, but he's God. When he walked on this planet, he was 100% man and 100% God. He was sinless, he was perfect, and he was offered up for our sins, for yours and my sins on the cross. And he went willingly so that we may have communion again with our Heavenly Father. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you this morning that that is truly legendary. So what is my goal this morning? My goal this morning is not to tell you that you can be legendary, or that you can be famous or well-known. No, my goal is simply this: to show you the only one that I believe has that title of being legendary, Jesus, and to ask you to follow him. It's interesting to me that every time Jesus called someone into the kingdom, he used two words: follow me. Listen to this in Matthew 4:19. "Then he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." In Matthew 8:22, "But Jesus said to him, follow me, and let the dead bury their own dead." Matthew 10:38, "And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me." John 1:43, "The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said to him, follow me." John 12:26, "If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also." Jesus is simply asking you and me this morning to follow him, to go on a journey with him, and to forsake it all. But you know who doesn't want that to happen? The devil. See, the devil doesn't want you to follow him, because if you truly, and I mean truly, follow him and forsake it all, then you become a danger to his kingdom, the devil's kingdom, because all of a sudden you're doing some stuff that he doesn't want you to do. And you've probably noticed this before, but the devil, anytime God creates something, he will try to copy it, to mimic it, kind of to pervert it, add something to it, just kind of mess it up a little bit. And he did the exact same with the idea of following. See, he knows that whoever we follow, we will eventually become like. Whoever we follow, whoever we listen to, whoever we give our ear and attention to, whomever we look up to and read about, we will eventually become like them. Whoever you really follow and look up to, eventually you will become like them. Satan understands this, I think, better than we do. And I wonder sometimes if Satan invented the follow button on social media. See, it is in us to want to follow someone or something that is bigger than us, because we were designed for a greater purpose. And if we don't give that purpose to Jesus, something else or someone else will take that place. And the reality is that many of us, we have started to follow other people, other influencers, other voices out there. And we often, even as believers, concern ourselves more about what these influencers think about certain issues than what the Bible has to say about this. Can I say this again, church? We follow people on all these social media platforms and we listen to what they have to say, and they all have opinions and they all shout them out. But none of them really matter unless they line up with the Word of God. And so some of us, we listen more to what they have to say than what the Word of God says to us. How is it that we start following these people and listen to them more than we listen to Jesus? See, the moment you stop following hard after Jesus, all these other voices will come into your life and you start listening to them. And the more you listen to them, the less you will listen to him. But P.S., man, social media and all these influences, they don't really influence me. They don't influence my behavior at all. I just, you know, I'm just in that world a little bit, listen to it and this and that, but it's not really that big of a deal. Why do you think they call themselves influencers? They want to influence the way that you think and behave and act. Media may not influence your behavior directly, but it can and most of the time will influence your values, and your values will influence your decisions, and your decisions will influence your behavior. So media actually does influence the way that you behave. Think about this for a moment. And I know this is more young people, but I've actually seen this with older ones as well. We obviously follow all kinds of people, and certain people, they post certain posts of themselves. And so we look at these posts and we think, well, I want to look like that. So some of our young ladies and some of our older ladies, we take pictures of ourselves and kind of post them in an essential almost kind of way, because we want to be told that we're gorgeous. We want to be told that we're hot and that we're all that, because it's all about us, and it's because we follow the people on our social media. Oh, just got real quiet in here. See, here's the thing. If we truly follow hard after Jesus, he's going to ask us to unfollow some people. Because some of us, we're following people that we should not be listening to. If you are a man, and I know this is a thing for ladies as well, but if you want to get rid of your lust and your porn issues, guess what? You have to unfollow some people. You can't follow these artists that are not dressed appropriately and post all kinds of stuff. You can't look at that and then wonder, why am I having this issue with lust and porn? Right. The news is because you're looking at it and you have to unfollow these people. This is good preaching. Amen. Amen. See, we don't like hearing that, but that's what it means to truly and fully follow him. If you follow him, it means to forsake everything else. I love what A.W. Tozer said. He said, there's a whole generation of Christians has come up believing that it is possible to accept Christ without forsaking the world. The early Christians, they understood this. When you followed Jesus, you forsook everything else. We in America, we often have done this thing where we take Jesus and sprinkle anything else in that we want. But it is Jesus, period, and nothing else. We forsake it all for him. Satan always mimics what God has set up. And he wants this generation specifically, I believe, to be consumed with being successful and having fame, having all the things that you want, especially here in America. And if our focus is on that, on being successful and having fame and doing all these things, then our focus can't be fully on Jesus, because we're so focused on getting that done. See, our culture is obsessed with having fame, isn't it? It's all about fame. Everybody, every young person that you usually talk to at one point of their life, they're like, yeah, I want to be famous. And we've all had these moments in our lives too. But that is in complete contradiction to what the Word of God says. See, when Jesus says, follow me, he doesn't ask you to follow him to be famous. He asks you to follow him to do what he does, which is serving people. Yes. That's what he asks us to do. And if you truly want to be legendary, then do what our master does, which is serving people. Being legendary is serving the people that God has called us to serve. Wow, that is so glamorous, P.S. What an amazing calling. I get to serve. Sign me up. That's usually not the response that we get when we ask people to serve. But that's what Jesus is calling us to do, to serve the people around us. So let's redefine what legendary means to us this morning. Legendary means this: there's only one who's truly legendary, and that is Jesus. And legendary means following Jesus no matter the personal cost. See, the world will try to sell you, make you believe the lie that fame and success is what you truly need. But what it's not telling you is that fame and success will eventually destroy you. Now, I don't need to tell you this, but just for sake of example, look at all these Disney stars, the young ones. 10 years later, what has fame done to them? Completely messed up their lives. See, fame destroys us. There's one thing that we really only need, and the psalmist, he had it right when he wrote this in Psalm 84, verse 10. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. And what the psalmist is talking about is the fact that we need more of his glory in our lives, because in his glory, our lives are transformed and forever changed. I remember one of the first times where I was in the glory and everything changed for me. I remember times since in camp and church services where the glory of God fell, or even in my own prayer closet, where the glory of God fell and my life was forever, forever changed. And here's what I've learned because of all this, and that is this: that we are not built for fame. We are built for glory. Now, let me define this in case this is confusing. What I mean by this is this: we're not built to receive fame from the world. We are created to be in his glory and to bring him glory. See, fame will always mess you up. Glory, listen to this, glory will make you into who you are destined to be. It is in his glory that you find your purpose and your destiny, because you're with Jesus and then he speaks to you and all of a sudden everything becomes crystal clear. Why will fame mess you up? Because it is in the nature of fame. Fame is about you trying to accomplish something to impress everybody else around you. Whereas glory is about you doing something that everybody around you says, there is no way that you can do this, and you do it anyway because of God. And then God gets all the glory. Every time we accomplish something great, we should point to him. See, when we as communicators are up here and someone comes up to us after the service and be like, man, great job on the message, which, again, we love hearing that. But I always say, yay, God, because I want him to get all the glory. This is never about me. This is never about Stefan. This is never about the communicator. It's always about the message and about Jesus. He should get all the glory. Now, there was a guy in the Old Testament who kind of had to make sure that he did not take fame for himself. He had this moment in life where he needed to give glory to God, and he did, and there was another moment where he needed to give glory to God, and we're going to look at both of these here for a moment. It's one of my heroes in the Old Testament. He's an older man, and he is, in some ways, I guess, legendary if you take it our first definition, and I just want to talk to you about him. He is a mentor, and he had a mentoree. And the mentor, he was a man who was rather shy and timid, but he was able to bring down the most powerful nation at that time because he trusted God. A man that was supposed to be dead and not even the picture, yet here he is, and he becomes the one that saves an entire nation from slavery. A man that was old and probably was long forgotten by his people because he had been in the desert, yet God shows him to do great things. A man that became who he was destined to be in his glory. It was in his glory when he met Jesus and God at the burning bush that everything changed for this man. Who am I talking about? Of course, Moses. Moses, the man who saw the back of God, the guy who spent so much time in the presence of God that when he came down from the mountain, he had to put a veil over his face because the presence of God was so much on him. A man that spoke to Pharaoh, the most powerful person on that time on the planet, on behalf of God. The guy who separated the sea and an entire nation walked through on dry ground. The guy who fasted 2 times 40 days without water and food. That is not normal. That is supernatural. If you fast, never, ever, ever try that. That was Moses, and we leave it with that. This Moses, he was pretty awesome. And he followed God, and he almost always gave God all the glory. But there was a particular time in Moses' life where he had a choice to either take his own glory or to give it to Jesus. Now, the setting here is that Moses had just delivered the people of Israel from Egypt out of slavery. Actually, it was God who did all the delivering, but the people had forgotten that part. They had forgotten that God miraculously, and you know the story, miraculously saved them from slavery. And now they're in the desert, and they're kind of like us. They're a little dramatic. And the story goes something like this. They don't have water, and so they go up to Moses and say, "Moses, Moses, we don't have any water. Why did you get us out here in the desert to die? Our livestock, our kids, everybody is going to die." And what does Moses do? Well, let's read what he does here and what God tells him to do. "Therefore, the people contended with Moses and said, 'Give us water that we may drink.' So Moses said to them, 'Why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord?' And the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, 'Why is it that you have brought us out of Egypt to kill us and our children, our livestock, with thirst?' So Moses cried to the Lord, saying, 'What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me.' And the Lord said to Moses, 'Go on before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel. Also take in your hand your rod with you, which struck the river, and go.'" Listen to this. "Behold, and I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it, and the people may drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. So what's the big deal about this story? The big deal was the rock. Not Dwayne Johnson the rock, but this rock here in the story. See, the type of rock that was in this region was a hard, red granite rock. And you hitting it with a stick would not produce water to come out of it. As a matter of fact, if someone was out there in the desert hitting the rock and they were asking them, "Hey, what do you do?" And I'm like, I'm hoping water will come out of this. You'll be like, "You've lost it completely. I mean, this is crazy." You would look foolish. You would look stupid. But if God told you to hit the rock and then water comes out, guess what's going to happen? God is going to get all the glory. And that's exactly what happened. Moses does what God tells him to do. He hits the rock and water comes out and he gets all the glory. God gets all the glory. And the people will once be reminded, yeah, God is the one. See, I told you this. We're not built for fame. We are built to bring glory to God. And Moses did a great job. Glory is what God should always get. And God gets glory in so many ways that we can do it when we live our lives fully fulfilled in the calling that he has on our lives or when we worship. And Liberty Church, don't we have more than 10,000 reasons to believe in him and to worship him and to bring him glory? Amen. Amen.
Sheriff in it, ooh, KBR, passing bars. I'm a lawyer in the booth. I ain't never seen nobody do it like this. Owns every inch and I rule it like this. Look at my world, that's a little like drip. Only go to my list, I'm like, who did I miss? Let it breathe, ooh, cool, let it breathe. Yeah, peace, peace, Jesus, that's my creed. Ooh, Michael B, yeah, he bossin'. Don't be a clown, but you're not it. Worship in a marsh pit, I'm in this palm like the tropics. Men and women get in it, they get it, then they live again. Good and generous, definitive, that's from the genesis. Unlimited, inhibited, look at all of these witnesses. Give you the business, Satan body, homie, he finished it. I got a God, don't change for the season. Yeah. 10,000 reasons, I can believe it. God's so good, say less, I'm breathing. Can't you see I'm on a roll? Been doing this since 16. Yeah. Rapping on the corner of the street. Yeah. Christ is God, I lost my father, but I never lose my peace. Yeah. I think he king, reigning supreme. Ooh, winning with ease. Ooh, you think it's sweet. Yeah, I believe way crazier thing. Cool, I see that he coming back. He said it, then I react. I got this thing in the bag. You go and laugh, I will be doing it last. Yeah. Friends with Matt, ooh, I got a God, don't change with the season.
Amen. Great job, young people. Well, well done. We have so many reasons to bring him glory, to believe in him and to worship him. I love the guy that is the artist of the song. His name is KB. And I'm very careful with who I listen to. And so I try to make sure that the people, even the Christian artists, and I mostly listen to Christian ones, even them, I'm careful to make sure that they are actually solid. And that they're not just out there in the industry trying to make money, but that they actually promote him. And so we were just recently at a concert with KB, and it was a lot of fun, and he had a lot of other guys there too. But one of my favorite things that I saw him do on stage, it was all about Jesus. I mean, he even talked about like, hey, I'm not out there. I don't want to get more famous. I want to be able to still go into the jails and do these concerts and these things in jails and reach people with the gospel. See, our lives should be Jesus-centric, and they should always point to him. By the way, I got to give a quick shout out. I don't know if she's in here or not, but my wife is actually the one that choreographs all these dances and everything. So she's amazing, and I just wanted to know that. She's doing a great job with it. I think she just stepped out. No brownie points for me. Oh. Now, a different story, but really the same people. It's Moses once again, and we are now in Numbers 20, and it's a similar situation with a different place, but the same kind of scenario. The people of Israel once again are out of water. And so they come to Moses once again, and they're coming to Moses, and as dramatic as they are, hey, Moses, all of our people, we're going to die here in the desert because we have no water. And Moses at this point is frustrated with his people. I mean, you would be too if they constantly come to you for water and are always complaining and can never remember that God is the one who does all this and who will sustain us even in the desert. So we read this here in Numbers 20. So Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly, where they had just complained to him, to the door of the tabernacle of meeting, and they fell on their faces. That's the right response right there. People are complaining, you go right in the presence of God. And the glory of the Lord appeared to them. And then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod, you and your brother Aaron, gather the congregation together, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield its water. Thus you shall bring water out for them out of the rock and give drink to the congregation and the animals. So Moses took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly before the rock. And he said to them, hear now, you rebels. Moses was tired. He was exhausted. He was frustrated. Must we bring water for you out of this rock? Then Moses lifted his hand and he struck the rock twice with his rod. And water came out abundantly, and the congregation and their animals drank. What's the big deal about this story? It's the rock once again. See, this particular rock was limestone. It wasn't hard red granite in this region, it was limestone. And if you know anything about limestone, limestone is not nearly as hard as granite. And as a matter of fact, there's times when there can be water in the rock, and when you hit it just at the right spot, water can actually come out of a limestone. See, Moses had lived in the desert for 40 years. He knew the difference between granite rock and limestone. And some of the people might have known this as well. So Moses, he had a chance to just kind of be the one that found water for them because he knew it was limestone, or to honor God and speak to the rock. Because if he would have spoken to the rock, see, now he's talking to rocks. Now he's not just hitting rocks, he's now talking to rocks. You would feel like, man, you are totally lost now. But see, if you speak to the rock and water comes out, then God is going to get all the glory. Unfortunately, that's not what Moses did. He hit the rock and he actually rebelled against God himself because he was so upset with the people, and God didn't get the glory. At the end of Moses' life, you would think that God might overlook, you know, his one indiscretion here. But at the end of Moses' life, you read something that is really interesting. Now the Lord said to Moses, "Go up into the Mount Abram and see the land which I have given to the children of Israel. And when you have seen it, you shall be gathered to your people as your brother Aaron was gathered." Aaron had already died, and he's basically telling Moses here, you will die before you enter into the promised land. You will see it, but you will not see it. "For in the wilderness of Zin, during the strife of the congregation, when all those people complained to you and you called them rebels, you rebelled against my command to hallow me, to keep me holy at the waters before their eyes." These are the waters of Meribah at Kadesh in the wilderness of Zin. Why was his punishment so severe? I mean, that's rough right there. One fault, because you were mad at the people, because you were exhausted, you were tired. Why was it so severe? Because he touched the glory of God. See, when you mess with the glory, you mess with something that's only reserved for God. What is the purpose of our lives, church? It is to bring glory to him. And we should never, ever touch that glory that is only reserved for him. If we state that we're followers of him, our cry is to know him and to make him known. And that truly is legendary. We're built to live in his glory, but we cannot sustain that glory in our lives if we don't live holy lives. A few weeks ago, we talked about this whole concept, idea of stewarding the presence of God. And that is something that we have to have in our lives, and it comes with holiness. It comes with living right and pure before God, and it comes with following the right kind of people and unfollowing the people that some of you guys may need to unfollow when you leave the service this morning. That would be truly legendary. In Matthew 7:24, Jesus tells the parable of a man who is building his house, and here's what it says. "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken them to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock." What's the big deal about this story? You guys are getting it. It's the rock. See, the rock here is Jesus, and our firm foundation should be on Jesus Christ. Christianity is not inherited by the next generation. It is an invitation that needs to be answered. Liberty Church, it's an invitation that we need to answer. And God this morning is asking you, follow me. Follow me, not with me and something else sprinkled on top, but follow me, forsake it all for my sake. Jesus gave it all on the cross. I think it's fair to do for us to do the same thing and to give all to him in return. I believe that's the call for us this morning. And you might be here and you have been kind of following Jesus and you've made that decision. I think most of us, you have. But I want to ask you, are you really truly following him? Or is there other stuff that you kind of follow as well? It's not bad to do certain things and to have fun and to hang out with friends. I'm not saying any of that. But is your life completely Jesus-centric? Is he the focus of it all? Are you 100% following him? Because that is the call that he has for you and for me this morning. Follow me. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that you are here and that you are challenging us and that you are inviting us on this journey to follow you. I pray, Father, that we will make a new commitment this morning. If we have followed some other people, that we will unfollow and follow you. That we will ask you the only opinion that truly matters. Come in this place, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. This morning, I'm going to ask all of our students that are part of the prayer team to come up here. I know we usually have pastors and elders, but we're going to have our students. We have a prayer team. So they're going to be up here and they're going to pray with you guys. But if you have anything special, any special prayer requests, I would love for you to come in the front and they would love to pray with you. But if not, I would love for you to turn to your neighbor and just kind of ask them and tell them, hey, will you follow Jesus with me 100% and forsake everything else? Let's follow him together. And then pray together, and then you guys are dismissed. But if you have any prayer requests, may it come forward. They would love to pray with you. They're ready for you to be prayed on. Amen.